The Newsroom.
Welcome to TNR on this date. Happens to be the 1st of May 2016. I'm Andrew Chamagiru, coming to you live and direct from Urban TV here in Kampala. A lot of things have happened over the weekend and we're celebrating the Labor Day. But first, let's have a look at the big stories making headlines tonight. Should one tithe gross or net of their salary? Celebrating the most courageous female journalists. And in sports, David Basajamivle claims the WBF light heavyweight title.
This is the Newsroom.
Well, proceeding with the big story tonight, today is a Sunday. How generous have you been in giving money to the church, especially the tithe? Tithe is a widely discussed doctrine in certain different religious settings. Well, Sarah Chisachi samples the debate, and here is the report.
Tithe is defined as one-tenth of annual produce or earnings given by the faithful to support the church and the clergy. The origin of tithing is rooted in the history of many religious denominations, including Christianity.
I think my interpretation of tithing is saying that, you know what, God, you have done these amazing things for me. I have been born until this time. I have clothes. I have these things. I have life. I am alive until now. And therefore, I just give you thanks.
In Arabic, the term zakah refers to an obligatory fixed calculable amount of money that the faithful give to God to help the poor.
Anyone who has got capital worth 18 million shillings, he's supposed to pay zakah. An agriculturalist who is farming somewhere, the day you harvest, out of that, out of the 100 sacks of beans, less 100 sacks of maize, you're supposed to get out of that at least 2.5% of that and pay it in zakah. People who have got businesses, we are not saying that the moment you clock 18 million shillings, the next day you're supposed to pay zakah. You have to take a full year running a business that is in excess of 18 million shillings.
But are there punishments for those who do not pay tithe?
The penalty is so grave that none of us will be in position to bear it. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says, the wealth that we accumulate on the day of judgment from which we did not pay zakah, Allah is going to form an iron, heats it, a heated iron. Then it is going to be passed over your body in front, in behind, the right and the left. And Allah will tell you that is what you collected and you did not pay zakah out of it. So the punishment is going to be very grave that nobody will have to bear it.
While many religious faithful tithe faithfully, debate still lingers on questions like whether one should tithe gross or net of salary.
And doesn't stop at 10%. It goes beyond 10% to 100, to how much you want to give. So it's from, and the Bible says that give according to what you have decided in your heart. And that's the best thing.
The word tithe normally refers to the 10% of all you get. 10% of all you get, 10% of your salary.
In the African understanding of Ubuntuism, one should use their wealth to generously support the community. Report by Serge Sache for Urban TV.
In another story, as the prevalence of cancer rises in the country, health management organizations have opted to offer cancellations in corporate companies to raise awareness and protect many from the deadly illness. Speaking at the second Human Resource Managers meeting here in Kampala, Herbert Mugonza, who happens to be a healthcare general manager, also called upon legislators to enact the National Health Insurance Scheme Law to this cause. Our reporter has more to this story.
10 years ago, having medical insurance was seen by many as a luxury only the wealthy could afford. Today, however, health practitioners strongly believe that health insurance should be taken up by all Ugandans. Herbert Mokoza, the IAA Healthcare General Manager, explains that as a way of prioritizing the health of their clients, they are now putting emphasis on cancer screening and offering cancer lessons to people in corporate organizations.
The challenge of cancer is a big challenge. And right now, it's not only manifesting in only old age people. all age groups affected. So what we advise people is to do screening a bit early to make sure that interventions are put in place to manage the condition a bit early. Secondly, as IA Healthcare, the largest medical service provider in Uganda, we have campaigns whereby we are going to our clients with the doctors to make sure that we do sensitization.
Mukoza expressed the need to move quickly on the health insurance law because economic development will be stunted without a healthy population.
Because the way it is at the moment is that penetration is low because people lack information. So if government deliberately comes up with a policy to have national insurance, we'll have a base, we companies that are engaged in private health insurance, to promote health insurance as a means of protection or family protection needs and business needs.
Officiating a meeting between the human resource managers and the health management organizations, the Insurance Regulatory Authority Chief Executive Officer Ibrahim Kaduna Bilubega warned against mispricing health insurance schemes and packages.
Otherwise, you realize when you give birth from a grade A hospital, it can cost you as much as 5 million, and the same can cost you as low as maybe 200,000. So that is an effort which is going to give guidance to the sector, and I'm sure it is going to guide the costing of the medical schemes.
Generally speaking, the insurance sector is yet to achieve satisfactory results as far as penetration and uptake are concerned in Uganda.
Now, 2014 was declared as the International Year of Family Farming, and in Uganda, a family farming policy was presented to the cabinet and promptly adopted. This policy is expected to recognize the family as the most important unit in the quest for food security, environmental conservation, and access to markets. In the following report, we assess the significance of family farming in social and economic development of a family.
Subsistence farming is still predominant in Uganda, and most of it is done by family members. Cognizant of this fact, government came up with a family farming policy to address issues affecting this model.
So we come up with this policy to help guide all these other issues. We want to know who is doing extension where. We need control. We need quality assurance.
Some of the challenges the policy hopes to address include the unfair distribution of roles by men and women in farming. Women are said to do most of the work, while the men only become active at harvest time. This has partly led to domestic violence. A case in point is that of Ninsima Kabonesa, whose hands were chopped off recently by her husband after she protested his intention to sell her maize.
And the fact that many things have gone wrong doesn't mean that we have to continue doing business as usual. No. You and me can make a difference. We can start changing now. And remember, change starts with you.
Besides domestic violence, land grabbing is another factor that affects family farming. A group of farmers from Kalangala recently dragged palm oil producer Bidco to court over what they described as unfair eviction from their land.
It appears that in the future, our families will disintegrate. If they evict 200 people from a village and do not resettle them, does that not imply that we have been impoverished?
The Minister of Agriculture says it carried out comprehensive consultation across the country to come up with a family farming policy. But does this policy address all these issues?
We've not had any breathing space. We have worked day and night. We have consulted widely. We knew that our farmers are very important, and we made sure the farmers were consulted far and wide.
The policy will also address several factors, including agroecological conditions and territorial characteristics, policy environment, access to markets, access to land and natural resources, access to technology and extension services, access to finance, demographic, economic and socio-cultural conditions, and availability of specialized education, among others.
You know, holistically, we are promoting subsistence farming, but we want to promote it in a better way. We want to appreciate every single person that gets involved in this kind of farming.
While 75% of the people involved in agriculture fall in the subsistence farmer category, the policy is expected to focus on eradicating hunger and poverty, achieving food security and nutrition, improving livelihoods, managing natural resources, protecting the environment, and achieving sustainable development, particularly in rural areas. Lubega Manuel, reporting for Urban Television.
With just a day to the World Press Freedom Day, 35 courageous female journalists in the country have been awarded for their extraordinary and professional reporting during the brutal and recently concluded 2016 general elections. Our very own Jaliet Namoya was named among those journalists who are courageous in the country. She found this report.
Jaliet Namoya is a general news reporter in the Urban TV newsroom. During the recently concluded elections, she covered several stories from the camps of the National Resistance Movement, Forum for Democratic Change, and Go Forward at the presidential, parliamentary, and local government levels. Namoya is one of 35 female journalists who were recognized by the Uganda Media Women Association for demonstrating extraordinary strength of character in pursuing their profession under difficult or dangerous circumstances such as oppression, threats to personal safety, and other intimidating obstacles. Namoya attributed her achievement to the passion and persistence with which she executes her duties.
I'm indeed happy for having been one of the journalists who have been recognized as courageous news reporters. I believe I deserved it. I'm one of those people who have left their comfort zones and have moved out in the field to look for better stories. Sometimes it requires taking a risk for you to come up with a good story, especially when it is for the good of the public and to inspire people out there.
Harriet Namwebia, one of the proprietors of the Uganda Media Women Association, started in 1983, recounted the journey of female journalism in Uganda.
Many of us were assigned as Uganda News Agency reporters, and what you needed to do was actually to try and work so hard, train yourself, because at that time the only media school that was there was the one at UMA. And it was only for certificate courses. So then there was no training. Right now there is a course in mass communication at Makerere that was not there before.
She urged the current crop of female journalists in the country to uphold the professionalism that is expected of media reports.
We need to ensure that actually people are actually professionals. And when you talk, but some of the things we used to have challenges with, I mean, they were mentioned here, how do people dress when they are going to report? How do a journalist supposed to be shabby? No, journalists are also have to, you know, they have to earn their respect when they go out in their communities.
With just a day to the World Press Freedom Day, which is celebrated every 3rd of May, the executive director of the Uganda Media Women Association criticized Parliament for banning journalists with diplomas from covering activities of the August House.
Parliament does not have, it is not written anywhere, that Parliament is supposed to be having the minimum standard for anybody to report about Parliament. Then thirdly, Parliament is a source of information, very critical information. Policies and laws are made from there. Meaning that for radio stations or the media that do not have the ability to employ a degree holder, for example, community radio stations, you will have denied the audience of this particular media, you know, information from Parliament.
Despite the increased level of media freedom in Uganda over the last decade, there are still calls for more action from government by journalists and media houses to let the media express themselves freely.
All right, we are now joined by our very own news reporter, Jaliet Namoya. This was named among the 35 most courageous journalists on professional grounds and on merit. Nice to have you, Jaliet.
Thank you, Chairman.
I'm talking to a star. So how does it feel and what does it take to be named among the most courageous female journalists?
Yeah, thank you for that question. What it takes, first of all, you have to have passion, passion for your work as a reporter, and then you have to make sure that you follow the five W's. You have to follow the principles of journalism, so that at the end of it, you come back with a balanced story.
Okay, so what are the most memorable highlights of your coverage of the 2016 general election? Because this was a benchmark to award you this, you know, award?
You know, covering elections, it has always been the hardest thing in the country and also in the world. So, as you all witnessed, what happened mostly was the harassment of the media people. We all witnessed and saw what happened at Kasangati. People who were covering FDC or Besigye's camp, they faced a hard time. You saw journalists being involved in running battles with police.
Which camp were you reporting to?
Me, I was covering all camps.
All camps?
All camps.
Okay.
But what happened at Kasangati, it wasn't good at all.
Okay.
It is funny how police could again turn their guns to the journalists. Me, a journalist who have just come to cover.
Okay.
That is totally unfair.
Well, that's there you go. I'm talking to a star here. So what is your day like as, you know, as a journalist? What is your day like when you wake up in the morning and you get to the road, get to the work? How is your day like?
Yeah, being the fact that in the newsroom we always have early meetings. By 5 a.m., I'm up. I start preparing myself. You know, ladies, we spend more time in the mirror because at the end of it, you have to come out beautiful.
Absolutely.
So by 7, I'm in the newsroom. I read through my mails, and then at 8, the meeting starts.
Okay.
In this meeting, we have to share story ideas, share tips, and you are also guided by your editor on the best angle you can take to come out with a better story.
Wow. That's the day-like of Jaliat, our star here. Now, now that you have this award, what change are you looking at? What are you going to advocate for now that this week we have the World Press Freedom Day? What is your feel about this?
As a female reporter, what I would like to advocate for, I want to ask the media owners to consider investing in media gadgets, protective gadgets.
Okay.
Like on several occasions, you are sent out to cover a story, it might be a riot, but you go without any protective gear, you don't have an helmet to protect yourself.
Oh yes.
And at the end of it, it is the reason why most journalists are injured or affected during such scenarios.
Okay. Mr. Kamshengel, I strongly believe you had that, even Mark too. Okay, now let's have a glimpse of some of the stories you're covering in the nearby future.
Yeah, in the nearby future, I feel like I need to traverse the country and do more stories on the ground, grassroots stories, so that I can tell what is happening at the communities.
Wow. You want to cover the community grassroots?
Yeah, there are so many problems down there that our legislators sometimes tend to underlook.
Absolutely.
So when you go down at the grassroots, look out for this story. Usually at the end of it, people's grievances or challenges are aired. So government sometimes, once they watch what is happening, they usually move in and give a hand to people.
Wow. There you go. Nice talking, Jaliat, here.
Thank you.
It is an honor. Talking to a star, it's not something I find every day, but it's an honor to have you here. Well, then, that will take us for a short commercial break, and Emmanuel Lepen will be coming shortly with the World of Sports, and I'll be back later. Keep it up on TV.
This is the Newsroom.